So in the last few videos, I introduced the two prominent programming models, message passing and shared memory. And for message passing, we said that this is a software intensive technique where there really aren't any guarantees being provided by the hardware, but it is up to the programmer to make sure that when someone changes a value, that gets propagated to others through send and receive messages. Okay, so in this case, this is a software technique in some sense, where the programmer is responsible for propagating values. And then we said that there is an alternative programming model, shared memory, where everyone has a common pool of data, and there are multiple threads that are all reading and writing data from here. Okay, and so when someone does a write into a location A, it is the responsibility of the hardware to make sure that a subsequent read by a different thread also sees this latest value. Okay, so this is not a software intensive technique. This is a technique where we are placing a greater responsibility on the hardware to make sure that values are correctly propagated to any sharers. Okay, so given that this is a hardware class, from now on I'll focus on the shared memory model. And in this lecture and in subsequent lectures, I'll talk about the functionality that must be provided in the hardware to make sure that these shared memory model programs behave correctly. Okay, and one of the main functionalities that must be provided by the hardware is called cache coherence, which says that each thread could have their own private caches. Okay, and there could be a cache copy of A over here, a cache copy of A over here. When someone does a write into their cache copy, that value needs to somehow be propagated to others as well. Okay, and so that's the functionality that the hardware must now provide. Okay, so I'm kind of showing that over here as well. I'm assuming this model like I showed in this previous slide, in that previous figure, where I said that there's centralized main memory, there could be possibly many caches and many copies of the same data. Okay, and so here's a more concrete example down below. Okay, so there's a value of X that at time zero is sitting only in main memory. Okay, so there's a copy of X in main memory, and that has a value 1. And there are no cache copies in either the cache of processor A or B. Then, processor A in time 1 decides to do a read of X. Okay, so that value gets brought into its own cache, and it currently has the value 1. Okay, in time step 2, CPU B reads the value of X, so it brings a cache copy of X into its own cache. So, there are two cache copies, and there's a copy in memory. They all agree that the value of X is 1. Then at time 3, CPU A decides to write a 0 into X. So its cache copy definitely gets updated. If you assume a write-through policy, then even the memory copy gets updated. Okay, but in this example, I haven't updated the copy of cache B. Okay, and this is not correct. Okay, so this is an example where the system is not cache coherent. Okay, so in time 4, if CPU B were to read X, it obviously moves ahead with a wrong value. Okay, so this is the behavior that we're trying to avoid. Okay, so when I do a write of 0 into A, I need to do a couple of things, right? I either need to make sure that cache B and memory get the value 0, or I need to make sure that these copies get somehow invalidated. Okay, and somehow if somebody else were to eventually do a read of X, it should return the value 0. Okay, so this is what cache coherence is trying to provide. It's trying to make sure that when you do a write into a location, all subsequent reads to that location should return the new value and not the old value. Okay, so if I were to define cache coherence more formally, a system is said to be cache coherent if it fulfills these two conditions. The first is write propagation, which says that if processor P1 were to do a write into X, and if you let sufficient time elapse, then eventually everyone is going to see this new value of X. Okay, so if P2 eventually does a read of X, it should get the latest value as written by P1. Okay, so write propagation just says that eventually every write will be propagated to everyone, but it does not make any guarantee on how much time needs to elapse before this write is seen by others. The second condition is write serialization, which says that if two different threads were to write into the same location X, okay, then eventually everyone is going to see these two writes. But we are going to enforce that everyone sees writes to X in exactly the same order. Okay, so if P1 were to put the value 5 into x, and let's say P2 were to put the value 7 into x. Okay, cache coherence does not enforce that one write happened before the other. It's perfectly okay if 5 gets written first and then gets overwritten by 7, or if the opposite were to happen. Both are perfectly fine. Okay, but once we determine that order, we have to make sure that everyone sees those writes in exactly the same order. Okay, so for example, we may decide that the write of 7 happened first, and then the write of 5 happens. And once we determine this, we have to make sure that every other process, when P3 is observing X, it has to see the write to X, so it has to see the write of 7 first, followed by the write of 5. Okay, so a subsequent read by any processor should return the value 5 and not return the value 7. Okay, so those are the only two conditions that must be fulfilled by a correct cache coherence protocol. Okay, and later I'll open a new can of worms called the consistency model. And that does a better job defining, when an operation completes and how writes to different locations, so a write to A and a write to B, how those can be ordered. Okay, so we'll talk about consistency models much later. But for now, we'll focus on implementing a cache coherence protocol that fulfills, these two conditions, write propagation and write serialization. Okay, and there are many different ways to implement cache coherence protocols. We'll focus on the two main kinds, which are called directory-based and snooping-based protocols. So in the previous few videos, I also talked about two possible multiprocessor models. We had talked about a distributed memory model that is a better fit for a directory-based protocol. And then we also talked about a symmetric multiprocessor model that is a better fit for a snooping-based protocol. Okay, so we'll talk much more about directory-based and snooping-based in the subsequent videos. Then you can also classify cache coherence protocols based on whether they do write invalidation or write update. Okay, and this is something I just introduced a second ago, where I said that when I do a write to X, if this value of X is being propagated to everyone else, so if I update the copy in B as being 0 and the copy in memory as being 0, then this is a write update policy. Instead, when I do the same write into X, if this value remains 0 and this value gets invalidated, saying that this cache copy is no longer correct, and likewise the copy in memory also gets invalidated, saying you should not be paying attention to this value, then that is a write invalidate policy. Okay, and so these are the two main kinds of policies that you could do when handling writes. And for the next few videos, I'll focus on a snooping-based protocol that uses a write-invalidate policy, okay? Because, the invalidate policy is certainly more popular because it requires less bandwidth on the network, okay? So for the moment, I'll zero in on a protocol that does snooping and that does write-invalidate. Then later, I'll also talk about a directory-based protocol with the write-invalidate policy.